inviting Dr. K. Sai, Dr. Shiv Shankar and Dr. Madhavan for the to chair the next session, please.
So thank you, Dr. Vijay. We'll go on with the next session. Again, another very interesting talk. I think it will also invite a lot of flow discussion. The first talk will be on crosstalk between liver and pancreas. We have known for decades about the role of liver in the pathogenesis of type 2 diabetes, and we are getting a lot of insights regarding the connection between beta cell and the liver. To tell us about it, we have Dr. Rajiv Govil.
Good morning, Chennai. Thank you, Dr. GVK, sir, for having me here. I'm going to speak about a crosstalk between pancreatic fat and insulin signaling, fatty liver, fatty pancreas, and also fatty kidney. So I'm a clinician. I have no conflict of interest for this, and take as many photographs and upload on Facebook or whatever, wherever you want, you know. My flow of presentation is I'm going to speak about the phenotypes observed in pre-diabetes. What are the impact of genetic variation? Sub-phenotypes of obesity and fatty liver. There's a crosstalk between fatty liver, fatty kidney, and fatty pancreas. The role of brain insulin resistance in the development of pre-diabetic phenotypes. So we all know that hereditary loads the gun and we pull the trigger by lifestyle and so many other things. But we don't know that why do some people progress from normal glucose tolerance to pre-diabetes, and some, in spite of doing everything possible, everything wrong, continue to be normal glucose tolerant all through their lives. So what is genotype? What is phenotype? Genotype is the genetic information responsible for a physical trait. It's an organism's full hereditary information. It's like your kundli. Phenotype is what you do in spite of what God and astrology has told you. It's the organism and its physical trait. It's an organism's actual observed properties such as morphology, development, or behavior. What is crosstalk? Crosstalk actually means that the malfunctioning of one organ actually makes the other organ also function abnormally. The most common form of crosstalk is sepsis. You have urosepsis and the patient goes into heart failure. Or you have urosepsis and probably he goes into a pulmonary hypertension. So that's a crosstalk. Sepsis is the most common form of crosstalk that you would actually see. But there's a lot of crosstalk which actually occurs in patients with diabetes, pre-diabetes, and normal glucose tolerance who actually progress into diabetes. So crosstalk is like a criminal plot. Last Sunday, we had the Easter bombings in Sri Lanka. So though they had people on the field who did it, there's a lot of planning which occurred. So these are like small sleeper cells which actually get activated, and these are sleeper cells inside our body. They continue to remain there, and when they get activated, it's like a criminal plot. All of them come together and you have a blast. So exactly the same thing is occurring in our human body. So I'm going to look at a prospective study. There have been a lot of pre-diabetes cohorts which have been studied over the years. One such comes from the Tübingen family study. It's a small town in West Germany. And they studied almost 3,000 patients, normal glucose tolerant patient, and how they progressed over the next two decades. Insulin sensitivity and insulin resistance of these 3,000 patients were taken up. And it's very easy that patients who had good or high insulin sensitivity didn't progress to diabetes. Patients whose insulin sensitivity was lower either had pre-diabetes or developed diabetes. They also had an interventional program called as TULIP. So interventional program was based on lifestyle, dietary modifications, and almost 400 of these patients were again followed up over two decades. And again, what they saw is that initially, in the first year, after 12 months of lifestyle intervention, in normal glucose tolerance, the insulin sensitivity improved and the insulin secretion reduced. In patients with impaired glucose tolerance, again, the insulin sensitivity improved, insulin secretion slightly reduced. But over a period of time, so in individuals with impaired glucose tolerance, moderate weight loss with lifestyle led to significant reduction in total visceral fat and ectopic fat, increased insulin sensitivity, and improved glucose tolerance. After 8 years, what was observed is that in patients who are even normal glucose tolerant, they started becoming insulin resistant. And because they became insulin resistant, they had to secrete more amount of insulin to keep the sugars the same. So without doing anything, also, some patients developed insulin resistance and the pancreas had to compensate. In impaired glucose tolerance, again, the insulin sensitivity worsened. That means they became more insulin resistant. And insulin secretion reduced. That means there was progression in prediabetes also. So the questions we have to address, what pushes people from insulin sensitive status to one of insulin resistance? What underlies the ability of an individual to compensate with compensatory hypersecretion of insulin? So that there are some individuals who are insulin resistant, but they are able to compensate so much over a period of time that they never develop diabetes. And some are not able to compensate and they develop diabetes. Is it genetic mechanism? So a lot of studies have been done and a lot of genotype, phenotype, we've been able to identify a lot of diabetic loci and diabetic genes which may be responsible, and a lot of studies have been done, but they only explain only 15-20% of the compensatory hypersecretion which makes people remain glucose tolerant in spite of high insulin resistance. So the genetics that we know about, only 20%. The other gene that we know about is the TCF7L2, which is the gene which is associated with incretin resistance, and there you have seen that it kind of shows that probably it is responsible some amount of compensatory hypersecretion. Now with the help of MRI and MR spectroscopy, they were able to also define a lot of sub-phenotypes of obesity and the role of hepatokines. Almost 25% of obese individuals have some form of obesity which is called as metabolic healthy obesity. So I'm in that 25%. And the rest of the 75% have what is called as metabolic unhealthy obesity. So with the help of MRI, you are able to find fat deposition in the neck, perivascular adipose tissue. You have ectopic fat in the liver, ectopic fat in the pancreas, ectopic fat in the kidneys. And with the help of that, they identify that most patients who have metabolic healthy obesity have more subcutaneous fat and lesser visceral fat. On the other side, patients who have unhealthy obesity, metabolic unhealthy obesity. So 3/4 of patients who are obese have metabolic unhealthy obesity, and that is characterized by a very thin layer of subcutaneous fat, more visceral fat, and again the most hallmark of this kind of metabolic unhealthy obesity is the non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. Non-alcoholic fatty liver disease is the hallmark of metabolic syndrome in us. And based on these, they were again able to, based on the fatty acid composition in these fatty liver, they were again able to identify or define two sub-phenotypes of fatty liver. One is called as the benign fatty liver, where the fatty acid sequences in the lipid stores, in the hepatocytes, are in such a sequence that they do not elicit an immune response. So they have fatty liver, but there's no immune response. So there's no inflammation, there's no pro-inflammatory markers. The other one is where you have a certain disruption of the fatty acid sequences in the hepatocytes and the lipid stores, and they elicit an immune response. And because of which you have inflammation, you have what finally leads to NASH, and finally non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, and finally chronic liver disease. And they also produce a lot of hepatokines, especially a hepatokine called fetuin A, which seems to be a kind of an agent. It presents these abnormal fatty acid stores to the immune receptors, and then you have an immune response, very similar to the molecular mimicry we see in patients with type 1 diabetes. So there is a derangement, and this fetuin A, it's an endogenous ligand. It presents it to toll-like receptors, because of which you have an inflammatory response. And over the years, in the next few years, all of us are going to become diabetohepatologists, because you have a lot of drugs which are kind of going to tweak this toll-like receptors, and probably for non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. Perivascular adipose tissue, again with the help of MR spectroscopy, we are able to identify there are a lot of fat around the arteries. So what is perivascular adipose tissue? Is an important target of these hepatokines. It's a specific fat depot with impact on organ functions. The adipose tissue surrounding the artery seems to have an influence on whole body insulin sensitivity. So perivascular adipose tissue has a whole influence on whole body insulin sensitivity and also peripheral glucose utilization. And it's independent of fat components like the hepatic fat or the visceral fat. So the perivascular fat is different from what we see in the hepatic fat or the visceral fat. So what happens in the perivascular adipose tissue? they produce and secrete a higher quantity of angiogenic factors, cytokines, and chemoattractants like the MCP1. They're particularly susceptible to organ crosstalk signals from the fatty liver. They stimulate hepatokine fetuin A, together with which it kind of produces a lot of inflammatory markers. Also, what one has seen, that fat cells are also found around the renal artery in the hilus of the kidney. And probably this is another subphenotype of the kidney itself. It correlates with hypertension inducible albuminuria in patients with prediabetes. It's also pathogenesis of diabetic kidney disease, and is responsible to the crosstalk from hepatokines. Again, the fatty kidney may be a subphenotype of prediabetes. So we have heard of the fatty liver. Now we have perivascular adipose tissue, and you also have the fatty kidney. Apart from that, you also have the fatty pancreas. Now, fatty pancreas has been associated with reduced amount of compensatory secretion of insulin, which is the defect which makes a patient from normal glucose tolerance to progress towards prediabetes. Now, if you look at fat cells and inflammation, the perivascular adipose tissue and the pancreatic fat cells secrete the same kind of cytokines. And anything which produces interleukin-6 makes insulin resistance. So the perivascular fat tissue is different from the hepatic fat and the visceral fat. Perivascular fat tissue is very similar to the pancreatic fat, and that kind of fatty acid signaling causes a disruption in the fatty acid metabolism and causing insulin resistance. Now, with the help of further imaging, one is able to visualize that the fat in the pancreas is around the pancreas, is sitting on the islets, and sometimes inside the islets also. And because of which, the speculation is that the fat cells in the pancreas, fat cells in the islets, and the macrophages have some form of a crosstalk among themselves. They are making a criminal plot among themselves, because of which, and this is mediated to the hepatokine fetuin A, which reduces the compensatory hypersecretion of insulin in patients with normal glucose tolerance, and they progress towards prediabetes. Again, brain signals have been detected at the hypothalamus, hippocampus area, perifrontal area, and a lot of studies, especially in this study, has shown that brain insulin resistance has a huge role to play in the peripheral utilization of insulin and the peripheral utilization of glucose, and causes insulin resistance. So patients who have metabolic unhealthy obesity have some form of brain insulin resistance. So brain insulin resistance actually kind of denotes how the fat cells will be distributed in the body, and you develop metabolic unhealthy obesity, because of which you develop a fatty liver, a benign or a malignant fatty liver. The malignant fatty liver makes these hepatokines, which makes all these fat cells which are distributed along our visceral organs to communicate and reduce the secretion of insulin. So insulin signaling is also thought to play a huge role in fuel distribution throughout the tissues of the body. Again, a lot of brain insulin resistance have been seen in young children and young adults, because of which they went on to speculate that probably brain insulin resistance comes in first and then obesity comes in. So with the help of fetal myoencephalogram, they were able to see that whether the fetus in GDM versus fetus in insulin-sensitive mothers, were there any differences? Were the fetus in GDM mothers developing brain insulin resistance as compared to fetus in insulin-sensitive mothers where there's no brain insulin resistance? And they were able to identify that fetus of GDM patients had brain insulin resistance, so probably develops right there that the metabolic environment which is there in insulin-resistant mothers or GDM patients induces some amount of brain insulin resistance, which has been picked up with a fetal myoencephalogram, and probably this leads to a different distribution of fat, a difference in dietary habits or dietary restriction or dietary satisfaction, which leads to metabolic unhealthy obesity, and following that all the metabolic consequences of metabolic unhealthy obesity. So what we have learned in our mythology, that while you are in the mother's womb, you can listen to a lot of stuff, you can engage a lot of stuff which may actually define what you do in future, like in our mythology is actually true. And probably that is what we are coming back to. So GDM mothers have fetus with brain insulin resistance, and probably that causes an unfavorable fat distribution pattern, which causes increased visceral fat, which leads to metabolic unhealthy obesity and the fatty liver, which produces a hepatokine like fetuin A, which kind of engages the fat cells from perivascular tissue, perihilar from the kidney and the pancreas. And all this causes an inflammatory change inside, which reduces the compensatory hypersecretion of insulin, which leads a normal glucose tolerance to progress towards prediabetes. So the consequences for prevention of type 2 diabetes, the subphenotypes determine the success of prevention methods. Some of these subphenotypes respond to lifestyle, some do not. So you need to identify them, and probably pre-diabetes also, you may have to use drugs. Lifestyle non-responders should be treated according to their phenotype. Type 2 diabetes prevention needs to start very early in life and with a focus on the gestational period. Studies are required to investigate and develop pharmacological interventions to treat fatty liver, fatty pancreas, exercise non-responders, and brain insulin resistance. Thank you so much.